Welcome to Annette on America, hosted by Annette Bybee, God-fearing, freedom-loving mother, college professor, lawyer, talking to you about all things freedom, all things America.
If you need a friend, don't look to a stranger.
And this is Annette Bybee, your host today. Thank you for joining me. I am a tired host, too many late nights. Or too many early mornings and not enough late nights. That's what happens when you have teenagers and they start going to early morning classes before school, and then they still want to stay up late and want you to stay up late with them. So anyway, if something doesn't come across right, or if it seems like I'm not making sense, oh yeah, she's tired. She's really tired today. Anyway, there's so much going on around the world. Some of the interesting things that are happening, Governor DeSantis of Florida shipped some immigrants to Martha's Vineyard. I thought that was pretty fun. I've been to Martha's Vineyard. It's not the kind of place you expect to see immigrants or refugee-style illegal immigrants. And so there was this funny meme on Facebook today, and it says, the scene in Martha's Vineyard right now, and it's got Homer Simpson with a sign, you know, one of those "In this house we believe" signs, Black Lives Matter, no human is illegal, et cetera, et cetera. And he's backing into the shrubs, and then he's coming back out with a sign that says no trespassing. I think that's pretty accurate. We're seeing some of these Republican governors like DeSantis and Abbott of Texas sending their immigrants to these sanctuary cities and sanctuary states to see how they like it. And I don't think they like it very much, but it's fun. It's fun to see that happening. You know, I don't know if it's going to make a difference in the long run, but at least it makes the point. It's your policies that's driving this rush to the border, which is supposedly secure, according to the press secretary. Of course, it's not. But anyway, also, Visa is joining Amex and MasterCard in tracking gun sales. After they said they were not going to track gun sales, then they turned around and said they were going to track gun sales, which makes me wonder if the Biden administration did not reach out to them and make some kind of strong statement. You better start tracking gun sales. After all, we are in the era of private-public partnerships, right? So Visa is private. They should be able to make that call for themselves, but somehow they made that change, and now they're going to track gun sales. So my best advice to you, use cash or check. Don't pay for your gun with a credit card. I know that's inconvenient, but it's better than being tracked. And then it looks like Biden has caved to the railroad unions, giving them a sweet deal to keep trucking or rolling or whatever. This just is an illustration of how powerful unions have gotten. And so even if you're a Democrat that loves the unions, you can't stand up against them. Because if he had, we would be in a real pickle with not having access to railroad transportation. Anyway, this in 2 days, it's Constitution Day, which is a wonderful day that you would think that they would be celebrating in every school around the nation, every college, every elementary school, et cetera. But you don't really hear much about it. It's not talked about much except for on the right. You see an occasional nod to it online. But I've decided I'm going to devote part of my show to talking about the Constitution in a sort of a roundabout way. But there's an article in the Patriot Post, Why the Left Hates Constitutional Originalism. And in my second half hour, I talked to Elad Hakim. I actually recorded that ahead of time this morning, since he can never make it during this hour. And we talk about the constitutionalism of a proposed abortion bill, either by the left or, unfortunately, by the right. So we have that. That's sort of the theme of today. So I'm celebrating Constitution Day by talking about how it's being abused. but don't forget that. Do something with your family or at least acknowledge it on social media. We need to be talking more about the Constitution than we do right now, because it's just largely ignored. by lawmakers, by citizens, by everyone. And so the more we can talk about it, the more we are reminded of the fact that this is a constitutional republic, and we should be checking in with the Constitution before we legislate. All right. So this article, I'll just start it. Elections have consequences. And nowhere is this more apparent than in our third branch of government, the judiciary. For example, Cal Berkeley Law School Dean Erwin Chemerinsky is schlepping a new book. I know this guy. When I was in law school, I was in California, and he would always come out for the left and debate with Hugh Hewitt on the right. And they were both California university professors. And so I got to see them live, and I was very familiar with them. So when I see the name Erwin Chemerinsky, I'm, oh, here we go. Yeah, all right. His new book, Worse Than Nothing, The Dangerous Fallacy of Originalism, about the horrors of Supreme Court's 6-3 conservative sort of majority and the philosophy that now increasingly guides its rulings. Originalism, which asserts that a legal text bears the meaning that it had when it was adopted. So this is something that Chemerinsky thinks is just terrible. Let me see. I'm getting a message from one of my listeners saying that I'm not on 1220 a.m. right now. So I'm wondering what's going on with that. I'm trying to get the attention of my producer. One of my listeners says I'm not on 1220 right now. So she's looking into that. I'm going to keep talking just in case it's, this will be on AM 560. If you didn't catch the beginning of this show, go to AM 560 and you should find it there. All right. Chemerinsky wouldn't have had reason to write any such book if things had worked out differently at the polls on Tuesday, November 8th, 2016. As lefty Paul Rosenberg laments in Salon, if Hillary Clinton had won the presidency in 2016, and if she had replaced Justices Scalia, Kennedy, and Ginsburg, we wouldn't be talking about originalism today. It would be a fringe theory on the Supreme Court that a group of conservative law professors kept alive. But Trump appointed three conservatives, joining conservatives who were already there, and that is causing originalism to be in the ascendancy. Indeed, here we are. Those on the left are gnashing their teeth because their ability to get the courts to give the power of law to what they could never pass legislatively has been foiled by five conservative justices: Clarence Thomas, Samuel Alito, Neil Gorsuch, Brett Kavanaugh, and Amy Coney Barrett, and one squishy Chief Justice John Roberts, who sadly seems more interested in being liked by the left than in being right on the law. And for those of you that don't remember, we have Obamacare thanks to Justice Roberts, who, I don't know what happened, but something happened and he changed his mind at the last minute and decided to say that it was constitutional. So, you never know what Roberts is going to do. But we have gotten some good decisions out of the court lately, especially Dobbs, which you will recall is the abortion law that basically overturned Roe versus Wade. And this is why people like Chemerinsky are freaking out, because they cannot handle the idea that these justices actually look to the original meaning of the Constitution. All right, anyway, originalism is indeed in its ascendancy on the Supreme Court, and Chemerinsky doesn't like it. In recent LA Times op-ed, my other listener says I am coming through on 1220, so I don't know what's going on. All right. Anyway, thank you, listeners that like to text me during the show, because I really do need to keep up. So thank you, Kevin, for letting me know that I am coming out on 1220. So my other listener, Nancy, I don't know what's going on with you, but I am on 1220. All right. Okay. Let me get back to this article. In recent LA Times op-ed, he refers to the scourge of originalism, writing, in case after case in the last term, the conservative justices based their decisions on their cramped reading of American history. Under that erroneous analysis, they found no constitutional right to abortion, a broad constitutional right to have concealed weapons in public, a constitutional requirement for government to subsidize religious schools, and a constitutional right for high school coaches to lead prayers at school football games. So let's just take that piece by piece here from Chemerinsky. They based their decision on the cramped reading of American history. So first of all, the right to abortion, which I've mentioned before. I studied Roe versus Wade in law school, and it's a huge stretch. It's basically looking at the Constitution and saying, where can I possibly find this right? I've got to find this right somehow. And then basically making it out of whole cloth. Oh, I see a penumbra of a right over here, and I see a little piece of a right over here, and a little piece over here. And if we take all of those pieces and we mash them all together, then we find a right to privacy, which then we decide is a right to abortion. I guarantee you the founders did not want a right to abortion in the Constitution, which is why it's not in there. Anyway, so the next one, a broad constitutional right to have concealed weapons in public. Yes, the Second Amendment shall not be infringed. Seems to me like it means that, yes, you should be able to carry your weapons in public. The next one, a constitutional right for government to subsidize religious schools, and a constitutional right for high school coaches to lead prayers. Oh, no, we can't have high school coaches leading prayers at school football games. Just a little something about that First Amendment right to exercise your freedom of religion. Seems like that should cover being able to pray at a football game. Yes, even down on the field. Yes, even as a coach. Because my right to exercise cannot be trampled by your right to not see me exercise that religion. If I'm down on the football field praying, you're not in any way required to pray with me up in the stands. And seeing me pray down on that football field is not harming you in any way. It's not forcing you to participate. It's not implying that this whole football game is a religious exercise. I mean, it's ridiculous. All right. Chemerinsky thinks this erroneous analysis should bow to the left's long-held and much-loved living constitution, which holds that the Constitution means whatever the political and judicial whims of the day say it means. A mere thing of wax in the hands of the judiciary, which they may twist and shape into any form they please, as Thomas Jefferson once warned. So Chemerinsky, Thomas Jefferson warned about you and warned about your friends and followers that think that the Constitution is a living thing. When I used to teach a class on Pakistan, whoever was the prime minister or president at the time, they switch power, so you never know who's got the power, would suspend the Constitution or change the Constitution whenever it got in the way of them doing what they wanted to do. So we used to talk about in class, what was the point in having a Constitution if it could be ignored or changed at a whim? Isn't the point of a constitution supposed to be that this is the rule of law, this is the law of the land, and you can only change it by amending it? It seems like that is the point. So if you can bend and twist the constitution to find things from penumbras, there's really no point in having a constitution. And we should have that debate. If you want to have that debate in this country, we can. Whether or not we should still honor our constitution, and or whether we should amend things. I'm all for an Article 5 convention of states where we have a convention that gets together and says we're going to amend the constitution. And we're not going to wait for Congress to do it. All right. This belief, this living belief, has resulted in all manner of unconstitutional rulings over the years, including the worst ruling of all, the court's 1973 Roe v. Wade decision, which was earlier this year, finally and gloriously overturned by the Dobbs versus Jackson Women's Health Organization decision. The living constitution approach has also been used to erode our Second Amendment rights and to grow an increasingly oppressive regulatory state and to generally undermine other liberties the founders had naturally envisioned and expected. Because you would think when they wrote the Constitution and they put it in place that they expected it to be honored and not ignored or gone around. Well, Jefferson knew people would try. That's why he said that. When they talk about the regulatory state. I think that's something else that the founders would never have conceived of, is to have this whole huge bureaucracy that can run, runs parallel to Congress, and it does its own thing without reference to Congress. I mean, there might be some congressional oversight, but by and large, it does its own thing day to day. And I think that's something the founders would say is highly unconstitutional. I think it was Larry Arn over at Hillsdale College that talked about how when you go to D.C., and you see the old, beautiful, historic buildings like the White House and the Supreme Court building and Congress, that those are the ones that are should be they're the ones that are doing the constitutional business. They're the ones that are right and just in doing what they're doing. When you go and find those other ugly, boxy buildings that are bureaucracies, those are the ones that don't belong. That's how you can tell when you go to Washington which ones don't belong there. One of these things is not like the other. And those ugly, boxy buildings with all those bureaucracies in them don't belong there. They're not constitutional. All right. The late, great Justice Antonin Scalia helped usher in this new era of originalism beginning in 1986. That was a fine year, by the way. That's when I graduated high school. Anyway, when he was nominated to the Supreme Court by Ronald Reagan and confirmed by a resounding 98-0 vote. Try getting 98 senators to agree on anything today, much less a Supreme Court justice. As Scalia's son Christopher and Ed Whelan note in Scalia Speaks, his proposal to rebrand original intent as original meaning laid the foundation for the conservative judicial philosophy we see on the high court today. The original meaning approach, they write, which aims to discover the original public meaning of the Constitution's provisions rather than the subjective intentions of the framers, soon became the dominant school of originalism, thanks in large part to Scalia's continued advocacy and to the powerful example of opinions as a justice. So again, they want to find out the original public meaning of the Constitution's provisions. In other words, how did the public perceive them rather than what was in the minds of the framers? So this was Scalia's addition to Supreme Court jurisprudence, constitutional interpretation. All right, somewhere Robert Bork must be smiling. In 1987, Chemerinsky writes, the Senate resoundingly rejected the nomination of Judge Robert Bork for the Supreme Court because it found his originalist views unacceptable. As a law professor, Bork argued that the meaning of a constitutional provision is fixed when it is adopted and can be changed only by amendment. Chemerinsky continues, Bork, who was impeccably qualified, was defeated by the largest margin of any Supreme Court nominee in history, unquote. Indeed, he was, but that didn't make it right. Bork was viciously smeared by the likes of then Senate Judiciary Committee Chairman Joe Biden, and especially by committee member Ted Kennedy. And the Supreme Court nominating process hasn't been the same since. So 1987 is when everything went downhill with Supreme Court nominations. Said Chappaquiddick Ted at the time, Robert Bork's America is a land in which women would be forced into back alley abortions, blacks would sit at segregated lunch counters, rogue police could break down citizens' doors in midnight raids. I just have to stop for a minute. Isn't that kind of what Biden's FBI is doing right now? Just saying. Anyway. School children could not be taught about evolution. Writers and artists could be censored at the whim of the government, and the doors of the federal courts would shut on the fingers of millions of citizens for whom the judiciary is and is often the only protector of the individual rights that are the heart of our democracy. It's a republic, but whatever. None of this ever came to pass, of course. Nor will Chemerinsky's hysterical warnings of originalism jeopardizing the right to marry, the right to procreate, the right to custody of one's children, the right to keep the family together, the right of parents to control the upbringing of their children, the right to purchase and use contraceptives, the right of consenting adults to engage in private consensual sexual activity, and the right of competent adults to refuse medical care. Chemerinsky is simply on the wrong side of originalism and thus on the wrong side of a monumentally important legal revolution. And hey, he's got a book to sell. So we know that that's what that's about. That's the end of that article, by the way. Chemerinsky has a book to sell. He's a lefty, so he's got to say what his lefty friends want him to say if he wants to sell the book. All right. Another big thing that happened this week was that Capitol Hill Police whistleblower memo lays out January 6th intelligence failures on Pelosi watch. So there was an article, and this was in Just the News 2 days ago. But I'm going to read a few excerpts from this because this is pretty earth-shattering. Just 3 days after the January 6th Capitol breach, one of the Capitol Police's top intelligence analysts sent a blistering email to supervisors blowing the whistle on what he said was their failure to heed clear intelligence warning that right-wing rioters planned to storm the Capitol. We analysts have been reporting for weeks that patriot groups are commenting on social media their intentions to storm the U.S. Capitol with overwhelming numbers, Eric Hoare wrote in the January 9th, 2021 email to his bosses. I don't know what was occurring behind the scenes, but I hope that information was briefed with the veracity it deserved and not just a one-time event assessment. He feared political considerations had overtaken security needs. So... Well, let's go on here. House Democratic leadership rejected an offer days before January 6th from the Trump Pentagon to send National Guard troops to assist Capitol Police. After facing retaliation following the riot, Hoare left the Capitol Police's intelligence unit and landed at the Homeland Security Department, where he is now assigned to train numerous agencies, including the Capitol Police, on how to avoid future failures like the one he decried in his memo. In his email entitled January 6th Intelligence Failures, Hoare wrote he waited a few days to send his assessment to the department's leadership because he wanted to let subside his anger at watching his colleagues needlessly fight off a riot that could have been prevented or mitigated. I have been purposely quiet for several days in order to calm myself, but know that I am filled with anger and frustration, he wrote. Watching videos of officers and friends that I served next to when I was in uniform being bullied, watching posts that I've held being overrun still makes me nauseous. And he goes on, the purpose of this message is not to investigate blame, but to hopefully provide insight to help prevent another disaster. He wrote at one point, candidly acknowledging the COVID-19 pandemic had made intelligence sharing harder. His assessment is directly backed up by hundreds of pages of internal Capitol Police documents obtained by Just the News showing Hoare and other colleagues in the intelligence division receiving detailed warnings from the FBI, Homeland Security, the U.S. Marshals Service, and D.C. Metropolitan Police that right-wing extremists were plotting to storm the Capitol and attack lawmakers. The intelligence was processed and forwarded to department components starting on December 21st, 2020, up through January 5th, 2021, the day before the riots, the memos obtained by Just the News show. Okay, so days before the riots, the Capitol Police were receiving all of these reports from all of these various agencies saying that it looks like there's going to be something really big going down at the Capitol on January 6th. Oh, and nowhere does it say Trump's going to come out and tell them to go over there and storm the Capitol. In fact, some of the intelligence was repeatedly sent in an effort to get leaders' attention over the Christmas holidays. Here's one of the quotes. I apologize if this is a double tap with the email, one of his colleagues wrote in an email dated December 31st, where he re-forwarded information from the FBI about right-wing extremist threats on social media to storm the U.S. Capitol and hang politicians. So they were getting some of these reports twice, like, hey, want to make sure you're not missing this over the holidays. Some of the threats. Well, I just so told you one. They were threatening to storm the Capitol and hang politicians. Despite all of the intelligence coming into the Capitol Police, the department's final instructions to its frontline officers made no mention of the potential warnings. For instance, the department's January 5th, 2021 final civil disturbance units plan for crowd and riot control contained this inexplicable language about threat assessment. At this time, there are no specific known threats related to the joint session of Congress Electoral College vote certification. So this raises some pretty big questions. Okay, why, if they had all of this warning from all these credible sources, was nothing done? Why was there no troops brought in like they did afterwards? It kind of makes me think that some of these threats were seen by people like Pelosi, and they said, let's let this happen because it's going to make right-wing extremists look so terrible, and we can use this to hold against Trump and the right for years to come. So let them come in and make fools of themselves. Or even worse, it's okay if we put ourselves at risk because it'll all work against the right in the end. So that's what seems like is happening to me. I just saying, what else can you assume? They're either incompetent, they didn't believe the intel, or they wanted it to get out of control so they could use it against Trump and the right. Come back and listen to the second half of Annette on America after this.
Are you facing a test of your faith?
Tests come in two kinds. The devil tempts us to do evil to cause us to stumble. God tests us to cause us to stand. What God wants to do is to make our faith strong and pure.
Join us for more of Adrian Rogers' series, Champions of Faith, this month on Love Worth Finding.
Monday through Friday at 7 a.m. right here on KLDC 1220 a.m.
This is Carter Conlon. Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 and 44, Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, and do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you." We're given the commandment to love our enemies and to look for opportunities to bless them. Today, many people don't know what they're doing, just as Jesus said once about the people during his crucifixion. People today will never know the goodness of God until they experience this goodness through you and I, his people. We know it's impossible to do this in our own strength. You and I don't want to bless those who hurt us, and we don't want to pray or love our enemies. However, it is possible to do these things through the strength of God's Holy Spirit within us. Talk to God about it today. It's time to pray.
Hide Thy Word in the Heart, the teaching, preaching, and evangelistic ministry of Lifeline America comes to you every first and third Sunday at 2 p.m. Join us as we share revelation from the Word of God. Thy Word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my pathway. The Word of God is the guidelines by which we live. Join us every first and third Sunday at 2 p.m. for Hide Thy Word in Thy Heart.
Uplifting messages with a positive perspective. KLDC 1220 and on the TuneIn app.
All right, we're back. If you missed part of the show, you can tune in Sunday night at 9 on AM 560 or visit my website at AnnetteTalks.com for this and all my past episodes. I also encourage you to go to Facebook and join my group, Annette on America Radio Show, and join the fun. We do polls, we chat, we have fun. Anyway, all right. Next up, I have a pre-recorded interview I did this morning because my guest couldn't make it during this hour. So I am now going to play this interview with Elad Hakim. All right. I am joined by Elad Hakim, who is an attorney and columnist. His articles have been published in the Washington Examiner, the Daily Caller, the Federalist, American Thinker, and other online publications. He's also a regular on OANN's Tipping Point and has appeared on Newsmax, The Jenna Ellis Show, Steadfast and Loyal Podcast with Alan West, The David Weinbaum Show, and Real America's Voice. So I guess the real question, Elad, is where have you not been?
You forgot to say your show. It's been my pleasure to be on your show.
Yeah, you know what? I want to see that. Next time I look up your bio under one of your stories, I want to say, and Annette on America's show.
You know what's funny? Every time I talk to somebody, they tell me, you need to put my name on your bio.
You know what? That didn't even occur to me until you said that. So I guess, you know, we're used to touting other people, but not ourselves as much.
That's right. You should do more touting.
So we had talked about what we wanted to approach this week, and we saw Lindsey Graham do something strange and interesting this week in deciding that he wants to put up a bill for abortion. So this would be obviously a federal bill, and to basically make abortion illegal after 15 weeks. And he had said before, like most conservatives, that the decision on abortion or abortion legislation belongs at the state level. So, I mean, isn't that kind of what Dobbs was all about?
Yes, that's not kind of what Dobbs was about. That was exactly what Dobbs was about. You know, Dobbs came out and said, and you know this, that that the issue of abortion is not protected under the Constitution. You can't find a home for it under substantive due process, right to privacy, equal protection. You can't find a home anywhere there. So because of that, it's not a federal issue. And the court kind of stepped aside and said, look, it's kind of out of our jurisdiction. It's out of our hands. And it belongs to the states, and the states and their state legislatures can determine the law when it comes to abortion. That is, you know, in a real quick synopsis, what the court said. So Graham, you know, is right. And everyone else who's saying it's a state issue is right, that it should be left to the states. And his decision to come out, you know, with this bill was, I think, just foolish.
Any idea why he would do something like this?
You know, I don't know. I mean, it's all speculative. You know, one reason some people have said is, hey, you know, he keeps going back and forth. He's kind of, you know, one of these quote unquote rhinos. So is he trying to sabotage the, you know, the Republicans' chances of winning? I don't know if it's that as much. I mean, I don't think he would do that. But I don't know why, especially looking at the breakdown in Congress, like this has no chance. This would have no chance of passing. So, you know, Republicans were facing, I don't want to say an uphill battle, but in the back of voters' minds, especially women, in the back of women's minds, Dobbs was sitting there anyway. But at least Republicans could say, you know what, we recognize the Dobbs decision, but now it's up to the states. You know, so it's not like we are banning something at the federal level. It's a state decision, and some states will allow it, some sorts won't, some states will have limitations. But now Graham and some of his GOP friends have proposed something that many Republicans went ahead and opposed when Democrats tried to do it. You know, Democrats tried to codify Roe, and Republicans, many of them, were up in arms. So, and why? Because, like you said, there's no constitutional right to do it. And it's a state issue. So what the Republicans do, they turn around and do the same thing. And it's just kind of laying a piece of meat out there for Democrats to gnaw on as the midterms approach. If you look at social media, that's everywhere now.
Yeah. I want to get to that in a minute. But backing up again, you know, I'm wondering if this is Graham's attempt to appear to be moderate, you know, because it's the left's position that we need a federal law basically codifying some of these really crazy laws. Like in Colorado, we have a really ridiculous abortion law that practically, or maybe does, legalize infanticide. And so then you've got that side, and then you've got the side on the right that says, no, we want it to be at the states, and we want restrictions, like a lot of restrictions on abortion. So I'm wondering if Graham's thinking, you know what? I bet there's a center ground here. So that center ground might be, we're gonna codify at the federal level, but we're gonna say at 15 weeks, because most people can agree that 15 weeks is a reasonable place to put a restriction on abortion. I mean, you think that might be his thinking?
I don't know, because I can tell you here in Florida, the governor proposed a 15-week ban, and it's been challenged. And I don't know if there is enough consensus and agreement on the 15-week timeframe in order for Graham to come out and propose it on the federal level. Not to mention that, you know, when Republicans should speak out, you know, when the president's home is raided, when, you know, when they should speak out, they don't. And when they shouldn't speak out, they do. Like, he should have just stayed quiet, because Congress can't do anything about it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't have, and as you know, Congress can only act if the Constitution allows them or gives them the power to act, or some law allows them to act. And as far as I know, maybe I'm mistaken, but as far as I know, they don't have a right to codify abortion. You know, the Supreme Court says it's up to the states. The states and the state legislatures have the right to make that decision. So who's Congress to come? Based on what authority?
Yeah, it makes no sense. That's why I'm trying to figure it out, because why would he go and shoot himself in the foot like this? Unless he thinks he's going to head off the Democrat attempt to pass pro-choice legislation. But like you said, it's got no hope at all. I mean, we don't have a majority in either of the houses. So I don't know why, unless it's a political stunt. Look at me. I'm so in the middle right now. Even though he obviously has to know it doesn't have a prayer of passing, and yet he's doing it anyway. It just makes me think it's just him.
I don't know if Democrats, I don't know, and maybe you know, but I don't know where they stand as far as, and I'm not talking to Democrats who are like for infanticide and mm-hmm. like in Colorado, where they allow abortion up to the date of birth, basically. Mm-hmm. And in California, where they tried to pass it, allowing it for a week after birth. But I'm talking about Democrats who are, you know, pro-choice, but also recognize life. So I don't know where they stand on where the proper cutoff is. Mm-hmm. And I think 15 weeks is there's no consensus on that yet. I told you, it's being challenged strongly here in Florida. And they're waiting to see what the Supreme Court is going to say about it. But interestingly, kind of as an aside, in Florida, the Constitution has a right of privacy, it kind of built into it.
Hmm.
So, you know, and if you remember from Dobbs, the Supreme Court said, listen, we can't find a right of privacy that allows it in the Constitution. But if a state constitution allows for it, then that's a different story. So the Supreme Court has yet to issue its ruling whether it's going to actually revisit it. Because in the past, the Florida Supreme Court has found that, hey, yeah, kind of abortion rights kind of fall within this right of privacy. But this is a new Supreme Court now. It's a more conservative DeSantis kind of appointed Supreme Court. So we're waiting to see what it shows. But I don't know where people stand. And it's just such a tough issue. And it's a dumb move.
Yeah.
By Graham, so close to the midterms.
Well, I wonder where that 15-week thing came from. Anyway, I remember when I was... my first pregnancy ended in a miscarriage. And so the second time I got pregnant, and I was already in my late 30s. So, you know, I was already kind of like, oh, crap, the clock is ticking. This can't keep happening. And so the doctor, when I was pregnant the second time, she said, okay, well, you know what? When you hear the heartbeat at 8 weeks, it's highly unlikely that you'll lose the baby by that point, right? So that was kind of like let's get you in here at 8 weeks. And if we hear the heartbeat, then we know it's likely to survive. And so that's what we did. So to me, 8 weeks has always been in my mind as, you know, that's when you know, that's when the baby's, I mean, I think the baby's viable from the beginning, but that's when you can like, you know, put a mark on it and say, all right, at 8 weeks, this baby's now more likely to survive than to not. And so, I mean, I'm as pretty much as pro-life as you can get, but I'm wondering where the 15-week number came from. It seems fairly arbitrary. I don't know what it is at 15 weeks that's magical, you know, as opposed to 2 weeks or 4 weeks or 8 weeks.
I don't know. I'm not well versed enough in all the literature to know. There's got to be some reasoning behind it. Right. Maybe science, maybe studies, maybe something showing
right after the
X number of weeks. Mm-hmm. But I just don't know enough about it to sound to tell you, yeah, this is where it came from. But I can tell you, there's no real consensus on it, which is why. I mean, Graham should have just stayed out of it. Republicans should have let it go and not brought it up, because this is everywhere now on social media, and it's going to hurt them, I think.
Yeah.
It's going to hurt Republicans.
It was a dumbheaded move, and I just wonder how that, you know, if what his thinking is, if he's somehow thinking he could head off the Democrats' attempt, because one of the biggest things that they're running on is, we're going to get rid of the filibuster. If we get enough senators, Democratic senators, we're going to get rid of the filibuster, and we're going to pass that federal abortion law. And so that's huge. Abortion is a huge part of the Democrat election plans this time around. That's their big, one of their big selling points. So I don't know if Graham thought he's going to get out in front of this somehow. I mean, it just makes no sense.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, but yeah, no matter what he says or does, it won't change the fact. I mean, Democrats are going to try to do what they're going to try to do, regardless of what Graham says. But what he did do is he weakened the Republicans' position as the midterms approach.
Yeah.
I mean, Republicans at least had the leverage, like I said, of saying, hey, let's leave this to the states. But now he comes back and proposes some some federal abortion ban. And, you know, that's what Democrats were selling. Even after Dobbs, Democrats were selling the talking point that, hey, Republicans are looking to eliminate abortion. Right. And at the point, it wasn't true, because all of what, you know, we said it was a state issue. Now they can come back and say, see, we told you, you know, they're looking to cut off your right after 15 weeks, you know, at the federal level.
Or though, you could also argue on the other hand, if you're on the left, on the right. Well, but see, you got up to 15 weeks. So it's never going to be fully banned, because we want you to have that choice up to 15 weeks. Maybe that's.
Yeah, but they don't want that. They don't want. They want to be able to control their body. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's, you know, if you were dealing with people who were, you know, middle of the road, you know, then you could have a conversation. But you're dealing with, I mean, listen, try to put partisanship aside for a minute. Who in their right mind could abort? It doesn't matter if you're pro-life or pro-choice. Who could abort a child at 8-9 months? I mean, I'm not talking, you know, listen, if the life of the mother, then, you know, but I'm talking generally allowing abortions at any stage of pregnancy is just asinine.
Yeah. It's ill and it's evil.
It's evil. I mean, it's just unheard of.
Yeah. So
and that's why it's so hard to find a middle ground.
I know it is hard. Especially as a woman, I find it that people, other women are fighting so hard for the right to kill their own child. I will never understand that. I cannot wrap my head around that thinking. Let's just say that by some crazy, there's a possibility that we do lose the Senate even further than we already have, and that they do get rid of the filibuster, and that they do pass a federal abortion law. Although I don't think we're going to lose the, I mean, I think we're going to regain the House. So I don't think it'll happen. Let's just say it did. For some crazy way, we lost both the House and the Senate, or kept those losses that we have now, and further lost the Senate, and they got rid of the filibuster, and they passed a pro-choice law that basically lets you do whatever you want, you know, total freedom. Isn't that something that would just go to the Supreme Court and be overturned, because they would say, hey, this is contra Dobbs?
Yeah, I mean, I think it would be challenged. I don't know so much if they could solely rely on Dobbs, because Dobbs basically said it's a state issue and didn't necessarily touch upon whether it is what Congress can do. But I think they would fight it on constitutional grounds, and basically say, look, yeah, on one, on first of all, Dobbs said it's a state issue, and Congress can't just go ahead and circumvent, you know, what the Supreme Court said. But I think they would challenge it on the Constitution and say, listen, they acted outside of their authority. They don't have the right to amend. You know, if you want to amend the Constitution, then amend the Constitution and do it the right way. And that's never going to happen. But for you to just create some bill to codify, you know, Roe versus Wade or abortion, that would be challenged.
Yeah. Not to
mention, there would be issues with state versus federal preemption, and what governs what. So, and they don't care. Listen, Annette, the Democrats don't care. I mean, Biden is trying now to just look what he did with the student loans. Okay, he's trying to forgive student loans by using a provision in some act that was intended for the military.
Right.
Okay. So they don't care about the law. Let's be just real talk. They don't care. Okay. What they care about is passing an agenda.
Yeah. Well, and we saw some of that, that ridiculous party that they had at the White House yesterday to celebrate the Inflation Reduction Act, which I'm using air quotes around that, because we know it wasn't that isn't what it is. All we have to do is look around right now and see inflation is much worse. It's going to get much worse. But it's like they are completely clueless up there. And Biden is trying to go ahead with this green energy that he's put through with that same law. I mean, it's like they're going to do what they're going to do, no matter what anyone else says or does.
So, and that's what that law is all about, by the way. That law is basically a green energy law that they call the inflation.
I know.
So you're right on. That's all it is.
I know. It's just a Green Energy Act. And it's really going to hinder us down the line if we can't find a way to overturn a lot of what they just put in, you know. But, you know, the midterm talking points for the left are all, well, their abortion is one of them, like we just talked about. But it's also Trump, orange man bad. And that's why they went into Mar-a-Lago, you know, 18 months after he got out of office, right? Look, Trump in the news again. Trump, orange man, still bad, right? It's all about Trump's bad, and we're all fascists or semi-fascists because we're Republicans. Because January 6th was political violence, and fascists like political violence, and they question elections, so you're all fascists. Just in case people forgot, I mentioned that last week. We cannot not vote this November. And I saw your piece on Florida and how it, you know, people, I can't believe Charlie Crist is still around. It's just amazing. But you made a really good point that Republicans cannot rely on numbers. They just have to get out and vote so that you can keep DeSantis, because Charlie Crist, Democrat turned independent. Or no, Republican turned independent, turned Democrat, right?
That's about it. That's right.
So long story short, everyone needs to vote, and they need to make sure they get their friends out and vote, because we need the red wave if we want to, and Graham's not making it any easier for us, but we still need a red wave so we can undo some of what Biden has done. I think if we have another Democrat president, we're done. We're toast, because there will be nothing to stop the whole.
Well, forget another president. If we don't stop what's happening come the midterms, the damage is going to be, I mean, I don't want to use the term insurmountable, but look what they've done in 2 years.
I know.
So if they retain control, God forbid.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm all over Republicans, because Trump said it best. Trump said Republicans are weak. They don't know how to fight. And all the, you know, everything was going their way. And then for the past, I don't know how long, all you hear are Democrat narratives. You know, jobs are good. Economy is good. Gas prices are down. Kamala Harris says the border is secure. I mean, that's absurd. But, you know, Republicans are looking to take away abortion rights. They're taking away women's rights. And how much pushback do you actually hear from Republicans? Like, you don't see Republicans holding press conferences. You don't hear the only person doing anything. Well, the only, but one of the main people is Trump.
Yeah.
Right? And they are terrified of Trump.
Yeah.
You know, so
Rand Paul's going after Fauci, which is nice. But you're right. What we should be seeing daily press conferences to push back on all of this nonsense. We should be seeing them constantly talking about inflation and gas prices and the border and Afghanistan and China. I mean, this should all be coming out constantly, and it's not. And it's a real bummer. So we are out of time, but I appreciate you being willing to come on and talk about one of our own doing something stupid. And hopefully enough of us will ignore some of that stupidity and still get out there and vote for our Republican senators and congressmen and stop this, because as bad as Graham is, the Dems are worse. So
absolutely.
All right. Thank you, Elad. This has been Elad Hakim. Can anyone find you anywhere, or they just need to go to one of these places where you're posting your stuff?
They can find me everywhere. Find me on Twitter at Elad Hakim, or on Facebook at Thoughtfully Conservative.
All right. Thoughtfully Conservative Facebook. All right. Thanks, Elad. I'll have you on again soon.
Thanks so much. Take care.
Thank you. All right. I'm back. Wasn't that a great interview? Elad's a good guy. Playing off of that, I saw an article by Newt Gingrich, or about Newt Gingrich and his formula for the Republicans winning the midterms. And some of his election strategies are stay focused. It's basically the message is stay focused on the problems. Inflation, especially the cost of food and gas, heating oil, diesel. You need to talk about prices of those constantly. He says actually you should campaign at gas stations and grocery stores, which is an interesting idea. And make people think about it right before they go in and get hit by those prices, right? Talk about crime. Tie the flood of illegal immigrants across an open border with the flood of illegal drugs and overdose deaths, which we see more than 100,000 per year right now. Insist on parents having the right to know what's being taught in their schools. Reform the Pentagon to enable us to stand up to China. Prepared, not woke military. So I think he's right. We need to focus on all those things. I like the idea of the grocery store and the gas station. Maybe you need to talk. We need to remind people they're getting hit in the wallet. Some more bad news. We had the report on the year 2020, how basically we went from sixth freest country economically to seventh. The fact that the U.S. became so much less free in the areas of size of government and regulation in 2020 should be no surprise. The rollout of massive COVID-19 spending policies and government interference in industry throughout 2020 represented a large growth of government that future taxpayers will feel for years to come. At the same time, business regulations increased as the government attempted to use its power to stop COVID. The author of the index, Dr. Guarantney, put it succinctly in saying, people will continue to debate the appropriateness of the pandemic policies, but there is no question that they reduced economic freedom. The danger now is that many of these policies will remain in place in the future. And this is infuriating because we should be number one. Every single year, we should be number one. And every year that we are not number one, we should be making changes so that we are back to number one again by the following year. All right. Do you want to get in while you can? Okay. I'm signing up sponsors right now. I'm going to start with my first sponsor, hopefully, next week. So if you want to get in before the space is taken up, and you have a great product or service you want to advertise on this program, you want to reach my radio audiences, plus my podcast audience, plus my Facebook audience, email me at Annette@AnnetteTalks.com or go to AnnetteTalks.com and fill out the sponsor form. Oh, and something just came in. Oh my gosh, I can't believe this is happening. Mike Lindell is still holding out against the FBI inside MyPillow fort. Holy cow. All right, this is brought to you by MyPillow. St. Paul, Minnesota. Mike Lindell, the CEO of MyPillow, had his cell phone seized by the FBI this week. Yeah, that's for real. That actually happened. The FBI is pursuing subpoenas on additional data and documents from MyPillow guy, but has been unable to breach his MyPillow fort thus far. And they have a big picture of Mike Lindell hiding behind a whole stack of pillows with FBI agents trying to get through. We are besieging Mr. Bit Lindell, but we had not accounted for the patented interlocking foam filling
being so difficult to penetrate, said Special Agent Bob Jansen to reporters outside the MyPillow Guy's fort on Wednesday. This fortress of mattress toppers, Giza Dream, trademark, bed sheets, and pillows have formed an impenetrable barrier we have been unable to breach. So far, Lindell has held off the armed agents with one-time free gift pop-up ads, followed by a round of invitations to join the MyPillow mailing list. Sources say Mr. Lindell is pacing inside the fort wearing night vision goggles and preparing his arsenal for a MyPillow fight. He's even wearing armor made from a MyPillow bathrobe over MyPillow formal pajamas and MyPillow slippers. All textured for maximum comfort, said Jansen. This won't be easy. Critics have contended that Mr. Lindell may risk being indicted for bribery if he offers a MyPillow to the agents. But even Mr. Lindell's harshest critics have not been able to disprove his claim that MyPillow products are the most comfortable you will ever own. At publishing time, Merrick Garland was forced to tie another string around his finger to remind him to investigate the Biden family's corrupt dealings with Chinese companies, as he had again forgotten. So you can find this up to the minute story over at Babylon Bee. BabylonBee.com is awesome. And I don't have MyPillow. I hear good things about it. But I hope Mike Lindell gets his phone back so he can actually run his businesses and turn up his hearing aids, because apparently his phone controls all of those things. Anyway, thank you for listening. Find me Sunday night, AM 560, or go to AnnetteTalks.com, where you can find all my past episodes. So thank you for listening to Annette on America, where freedom lovers gather.
Thanks for listening to Annette on America. And join her again next week as she talks all things freedom, all things America.